I want just to say that the Brazilian Academy of Sciences is extremely happy with your presence here, especially so because this topic of excellency in higher education is fundamental for all our countries and people. And this is a great event for our academy, and I wish just that you conclude your work very well and enjoy the remaining part of your stay in Brazil and in beautiful Rio de Janeiro. I always say that, which is true. Please come back to Rio, come back to the academy, and let's be together in the pursuit of our dream of having very good higher education in our countries. Thank you very much.
Issues of higher education financial support. My name is Baocheng Yang. I'm a vice president of Huanghe Science Technology University in China. It's the first private university certified by the Chinese government. So today we're going to have our presenter from US, Francisco. Francisco is an distinguished educator. Right now he hosts the World Bank's lead tertiary education specialist and the coordinator of its network of higher education specialists. Previously, he served as a founding executive director of a consortium for North American Higher Education Collaboration, a network of more than 160 higher education institutions. Also, he worked as an assistant vice president for University of Arizona. Today, he's going to give us a talk about financing tertiary education in a resource-limited environment in the case of BRICS countries. Let's give a welcome to have a great talk.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share with you some perspectives on the subject that is of a lot of interest to everybody. So Simon, thanks a lot for your great invitation, and thanks to the Academy for the great hospitality in these 2 days, in which I think we have had very meaningful discussions on what and how the importance of tertiary education in the BRICS country is going to be shaping, in a way, the landscape of tertiary education all over the world in future years. I'd like to share with you sort of a perspective, not necessarily from the World Bank, but because I have been influenced by the World Bank just in the last 3 years. But basically, what I do, and I have been observing on tertiary education for many years since I was a student in Mexico, my own country, and then later, thanks to the great opportunity that I have had to travel to more than 70 countries in which I have been able to study and to observe and to see how different and at the same time similar is tertiary education. So, and I think in order to see the very specific subject of financing of higher education or tertiary education, I think we need to go a little bit beyond the limits and to try to see the larger picture and how some of the different elements of what is happening outside tertiary education and outside funding of tertiary education
probably has a significant influence on that. So some of the key challenges that we see from the World Bank in tertiary education in the world, I'm sure that probably you will see them as very relevant in the BRICS countries. The first one is that we see all over the world a tremendous bias towards universities as the only place where people can have meaningful tertiary education preparation. And that significant bias, of course, introduces a lot of, I might say, distorted behaviors in governments and parents and students and society at large by idealizing that the only place where I can learn and have the title is from a prestigious university. And then the ideal of a prestigious university is this research-oriented, intensive research-oriented institution, which, as you know, it doesn't represent the overall landscape of tertiary education in the world. It is just a very tiny, small percentage of where, in reality, people receive tertiary education all over the world. So we need to try to see a little bit beyond the conventional. The second challenge we see is that there are significant limitations in the pathways that exist allowing mobility of students inside the tertiary education systems. In some countries, even those roads don't exist. So if you are in the two-year technical education component of a tertiary education system, that is the end of the road. And that creates a very unfortunate, significant stratification of the tertiary education system in such a way that, with a few exceptions, the ones who attend those type of institutions are the ones who come not from the better off sectors of the society, but from the ones which are less privileged. And then the ones who are able to go to those prestigious institutions that are extremely strict in receiving those students who are not part of the family usually come from the better off sectors of our society, which, by the way, are the ones who don't, most of the times, probably may be able to contribute better to the funding of tertiary education than the other ones which are receiving a very lousy quality of tertiary education. Of course, I'm not talking about Brazil, right? I'm just talking about any other country. That I know that that doesn't happen here. So quality control and assurance regulations and mechanisms all over the world have been improving, but still are relatively weak. And in many countries, we see that quality assurance becomes just a check mark. And also, it becomes a great opportunity for the institutional leadership to be on the newspapers saying that now my institution is the best in the world, even though that is, doesn't translate into the improvement of the day-to-day teaching learning activity of the institution. And again, I'm just talking about other parts of the world. Significant challenge in tertiary education, which impacts, of course, funding of tertiary education, has to do with equity. And it is great news that more people are having access to tertiary education in the world. But still, when you dissect the information, unfortunately, you know, there are significant sectors of the societies which are not having access to that significant component of the mobility, economic and social mobility in our country. So still there are significant disparities in access across regions. And of course, limited efficiency and limited engagement of institutions with the surrounding community. This traditional paradigm of universities as ivory towers, still it is very persistent in many places. And this idea of isolating the institution from the environment in order not to be contaminated by the day-to-day nuances of our societies, in some cases it is taken to the extreme. And that isolation from the surrounding community, of course, creates significant challenges and skepticism that more and more societies are expressing about what the heck is going on in our tertiary education institutions. And again, I'm just talking about other countries. Insufficient investment in tertiary education. You know, we see the numbers, and overall societies still need to invest. In some countries, the proportion of investment in tertiary education is extremely low. because there has been, what I believe, some kind of opportunistic role of states in sort of diverting that from the other components, which is understandable, of course. Policy and investment decisions are often based on inaccurate, biased, or incomplete information. And again, that influences a lot the public policy decisions, and of course influences a lot the public policy domain in whatever matter is that. Lack of knowledge of job market, which prevents institutions from transparently sharing information about employability, demanded skills, and costs with students. So in many countries, we see that that limited information causes students to think that what they are going to be studying is going to pay back, to think that they will have a decent job, to think that it's worth it to assume a huge debt that probably they might not be able to pay back. And then somebody will have to pay that. We think that, well, you know, he or she has a problem. Society at large has a problem. So in some countries that have transitioned the funding scheme in tertiary education mostly towards the families and the individuals, when those weak mechanisms for sharing information are there, at the end of the day, the entire society may pay back because somebody will have to pay. And the somebody will be, again, the entire society. And finally, another challenge we see in tertiary education is that there are still weak linkages of tertiary education with the agendas of research and innovation and regional development. And again, yesterday Renato shared some information about the impact of research, which shows very clearly that that is an issue. So anyways, this is kind of the not very rosy picture that I wanted to share with you to begin with, and then chatting about the fact of what is going on with the funding. So in reality, there has been a significant progress in tertiary education in BRICS country. This is the good news. And all of you involved in tertiary education in BRICS should be very proud of that, because at the end of the day, it's the result of societies, educators, and government investing in and thinking that tertiary education is a good investment for society. We see the numbers. You know, total enrollment in tertiary education in BRICS countries, it is quite large. This is the landscape of just 1 year in terms of the size of the tertiary education system. But if we see that all over the years, you may see very interesting trends. Look at the case, for instance, of Brazil has been sort of going up constantly. The case of China, that's getting much larger. The case of India, Russia is the only one that has had a small decline in the size of the tertiary education enrollment, and we will see why later. And then, unfortunately, in UNESCO's database, the information from South Africa is only available for the year 2013. So we don't have a way to see that progressive analysis of how tertiary education has been evolving in South Africa, but for sure, as it was explained yesterday, it has been a significant growth in tertiary education as well. So, but this is not exclusive of the BRICS countries, and that's why we should think that while we are walking, others are walking and probably are running. So look at the chart on the growth that tertiary education has had all over the world, with the exception of sub-Saharan Africa and a little bit of the MENA region. In general, all over the world, there has been a significant growth in tertiary education. So that we have witnessed in our generation a significant growth, massification of tertiary education. This is part of the good news, or sometimes not always very good news, as we will see after. So if we see the BRICS countries as a pie, that's the way those are distributed. You know, China represents about a little bit less than half of the students in tertiary education in the BRICS countries, followed by India, and then a smaller share of Brazil, Russia, and South Africa. If we see tertiary education enrollment in BRICS as a percentage of the global tertiary education enrollment, there is a very interesting contribution that you are making towards the world landscape of tertiary education. Globally, as you may know, tertiary education enrollment has increased in 10 years about 61% all over the world. about 61%. However, the enrollment in BRICS countries has increased in the same period of time almost a double. It has doubled the total enrollment in tertiary education. In such a way that as of today, out of 10 students in tertiary education in the world, 4 are in your countries. In other words, you represent almost the half of the total tertiary education enrollment all over the world. Of course, if we talk about diversity of the systems, as yesterday was a little bit explained in the case of India, there is a huge diversity in the system of tertiary education. And the question is if that infrastructure, that capacity in tertiary education is enough to cope with the population growth that your region is going to, or your respective countries are is going to be receiving in future years. And then here, it's unavoidable that we need to make some scenarios. And some scenarios may look some optimistic, others might look a little bit pessimistic. So let's go into the optimistic side of the analysis of scenarios. So let's see what is going to happen in the world in terms of population by the year 2050. This is how the world was in 1950. And you can see there the BRIC countries. South Africa is not included because at that time, South Africa, I think the total population was about 13 million people. And you can see that China, India, Russia, and Brazil were among the top 8 largest countries in the world in terms of population. By the year 2000, China and India, Brazil, Russia is starting to get low. And by the year 2050, Russia will be out of the league of the largest world countries in the world, while India will become the most populated country in the world. So sorry, our colleagues from Russia are going to be not anymore on the league of the most populated countries in the world. Well, that's right. And the access rate to higher education probably too. So in other words, the population growth in BRICS countries is going to have a very interesting dynamics. This is, again, the 1950, the year 2000, the year 2013, which is the most recent data, and by the year 2050. So there is going to be a significant, interesting shift in the way that population is going to be growing in the BRICS countries. And that is, in a way, explained by the fact, as you know very well, that from now to the year 2050, population in the developed countries, as they are defined today, is going to be shrinking, while the population growth in the world will happen in the developing countries, which, by the way, are the ones who have younger people and are the ones who have less money, right? So it is going to be a significant recomposition, I might say, of the human capital in the world. And the question is, who's going to pay for the education of the ones which are going to be working by the year 2050 in order to pay the pensions of the ones, like myself, I hope, that are going to be retired? Because I'm hoping to be there by the year 2050. Anyways, and that is an interesting challenge. You know, look at the case of Italy. I took this picture in Rimini last year, and it was very interesting to see that picture of, as you can see, society which is not having kids anymore. As you know, the sales of diapers for adults in Italy is larger than the sales of diapers for kids. And that, you know, can tell you a little bit about the recomposition, not only of the factories of diapers, but also, believe it or not, about the composition of education. And currently in the BRICS countries, the big challenge that we see all is more space in higher education, right? More people are coming. Is that going to stay forever? Probably not. Look at what happens in countries such as Japan right now, Armenia, Albania, even here in the Americas, in Puerto Rico. Last year, they had to close lots of secondary schools. Why? Because they were not complying with regulations? No. For a very simple reason. There are not students anymore. So there is going to be a significant shift in the way we understand growth in tertiary education right now. And again, the big question is, who's going to be paying for that? So this graying of societies in the world is going to be impacting dramatically the way that tertiary education is going to be shifting. By the year 2050, look at the case of Japan, where the great majority of the population will be people who are retired or are younger to work. In other words, there will be a very small number of people working, again, in order to pay for the ones who don't work. So if we translate that to tertiary education, what is the implication? Well, globally, as you know, more than ever, more people are having access to tertiary education. The growth has been kind of differential. In some parts of the world, China and BRICS countries in general has been dramatic, while others have not been as successful in achieving the goal of having more people with tertiary education. Nevertheless, the projections of the number of people which have tertiary education, despite of the scenarios, are all of them positive. Most of them, you know, basically we are facing and we will be facing yet in the future years an increased growth in tertiary education. However, despite those big numbers of more people having access to tertiary education, still enrollment in tertiary education as a proportion of the total population in the world continues being relatively low. And again, you may see regions of the world such as sub-Saharan Africa, which by the way, as you know, is the region of the world that will experience the most dramatic growth in population. It's gonna be the young continent of the future, but still the access to tertiary education there is very low in comparison to other parts of the world. So let's see specifically the case of the BRICS countries. Tertiary education, despite that growth, still continues being just a privilege for few, with the exception of Russia, that has had a very remarkable access rate to tertiary education. The rest of the world in the BRICS countries, still there is a big challenge. Look at the case of China, 4%, just 4%, despite that growth. So the case of Brazil, about 13%. So some relevant facts, just to end this section. Demographic is and will continue being a major driver in growth in tertiary education. And secondly, tertiary education experience and will continue experience tremendous growth and diversification. So don't worry about losing your job. There will be plenty of things to do in future years because tertiary education, at least in the BRICS countries, will continue growing. So, but what are the implications of the global growth in tertiary education? Well, first and more interesting is that soon the developing countries will have the greatest share of the worldwide tertiary education enrollment. It won't be in the developed countries. It will be in the developing countries where most of the students in tertiary education will be. Secondly, it is in those economies, including the BRICS, where the future profile of what do we mean by global tertiary education will be defined. It won't be defined there. It will be defined here. And finally, worldwide, tertiary education will transition more and more from a still elitist approach towards a much more flexible access model in tertiary education. So if we try to see the future in tertiary education, well, of course, there will be, no question about that, a dramatic diversification of modalities and the type of providers of tertiary education. The funding model, of course, will have a significant influence on that. Secondly, the role of technology. Third, the multinationalization of tertiary education, which is happening now. We might not see that, but it is a reality in today's world. And also the issue of portability of credentials in a global society which will be more and more mobile, as we are seeing very recently for the events that are happening right now in Europe and in other parts of the world. And let me propose to you that this will challenge the traditional assumption of what we understand as higher education, tertiary education, or university education. So one question that always we think about is if the many graduates of tertiary education will have a job. And that's where the supply and demand becomes very tricky. Because, on one way, we recognize that legitimate right that everybody has to have tertiary education. It is a dream that is achievable, why not? But on the other side, there is a limited capacity of economies to absorb the graduates of the tertiary education. And then who should decide that? The state, the market, the individuals? There is no solution to that. But for sure, there is some capacity that states may have in making sure that this alignment between supply and demand is in between certain limits. Otherwise, uneasy situations may happen in societies, as we are seeing right now happening in other parts of the world. You know, paradoxically, it is interesting to see that when you ask the employers, usually they tend to complain, saying that what we do in tertiary education is pretty bad, that the graduates of tertiary education institutions don't have the right skills, and that they have huge difficulties to find jobs. You know, always I'm a little bit skeptical about that position from the employers, because many times I recognize that the employers have no clue about what they need, and probably sometimes they have no clue of what they will need in the future, not what they need right now. And also many times there is, I grew up in a home in which we had a business, and so I know that people doing business like to complain because that's the way we do. And it's always the employers want to have the best graduates and with all the skills and all the experience, and also to pay half of what the graduate deserves. So of course there is this particular challenge, but there is something that it is telling us the economy when we see that many graduates of our tertiary education institutions are not having the jobs that, among other things, will pay the debts that they have. So interestingly, when you ask employers and educators about how wonderful are the graduates of the institutions, if you ask the educators in this study, for instance, 72% of the educators, they say graduates are great. You know, the best ones in the world are getting out from my institution. But then when you ask the employers, they say, 58% of them say, they are not. So I assume that the labor market is demanding a combination of skills, which sometimes is different to the one that is being provided by our tertiary education institutions. And of course, we know that what we learn in school not always is reflecting what it happens in the world. And the question is not how good our graduates are in accumulating knowledge, but more important, in the capacity they have to continue learning the rest of their life in a context that for sure will be different to the one for which they were educated. So, in summary, is there a demographic bonus in BRICS? Yes, there is a demographic bonus here. However, there are some issues to take in consideration. Look at what happens with the population which is going to be knocking the doors of tertiary education institutions. In fact, right now, this is the information up to 2013. That means that those kids, at that time 14 years old, now are 17, so they are the ones which are getting into your institutions very soon. Look at country per country. The case of Brazil. The case of China, dramatic. India, Russia, and South Africa. So there is a demographic bonus, right? But it looks like the demographic bonus is starting to slip away a little bit. So there will be increased pressure for access to tertiary education, for sure, but not for many years. That is going to start. In fact, it started to decline in the case of Brazil this year, I believe. And in other big countries, well, look at the case of China. The only one that will not have this problem in the short term will be India. The rest of the countries, and you know, the case of Russia is the much more dramatic, just in considering the way that the graying of the society is happening. So if we see that as a percentage of the total population, look at, again, how it is going. The case of Brazil, China, India, Russia, and South Africa. Very similar to India, by the way. So this is getting out. So the window of opportunity that societies in BRICS countries have to enable the next generation of workers, of actors in the economy, is relatively short, if I may suggest to you. So, for instance, when you see the case of Brazil, the projected evolution of the schooling cohorts, the only one that it has had kind of a relatively stable but now starting to decline is tertiary education. It is amazing to see that the population decline in previous levels is so dramatic, and again, the only one that is still it is yielding from the previous generations is the university level. So the other element is the if the graduates of tertiary education are going to stay, or what is going to happen. So the reality of today is that we live in a much more mobile society, and there will be increased migration towards the developed world, obvious reasons. You know, people ask me in the U.S. about the case of Mexico, and I said, well, just put it in this way. If you in your family will have someone who tells you that you will have a job opportunity that is going to be 10 times larger than what you have in your place, are you going to be tempted by that or not? Or I say, or the opposite. Just imagine, I say to them, that from now to tomorrow, somebody will tell you that your revenues, your salary, is going to be reduced 90%. Are you going to be able to survive with that? Or are you going to be looking for something else? So there is a natural desire of people to have better life, whatever is available. And if that is not available at home, people will continue looking for those opportunities abroad, especially the ones which are in desperate situation. And especially, believe it or not, some of the ones who have already higher education skills and recognize that probably at home are not having the opportunities that they believe they deserve. So in a way, we are creating the own phenomenon that is going to be impacting the world in future years. So what we have seen again in recent months, in my opinion, is just a manifestation of something that is going to be much more critical in future years. So I venture to assume that there will be a brutal pressure for talent in the future years, no matter what, no matter where. And again, that is going to be having a significant implication for BRICS countries. As we become much more part of a global economy, which is highly competitive, technologically driven, constantly changing, and more an economy that is based in knowledge, there is no question about the fact that there is an evident connection between education, economic development, and social development. Look at these charts. Globally, skills demands is shifting more and more towards what as are being seen the new economic skills. This is the case of OECD countries, and you can see how there is a decline in the routine cognitive or manual or non-routine manual work, while there has been an increase in non-routine cognitive or interpersonal skills. The same happens, in a way, in developing countries, probably not as acute as in developed societies, because there has been a shifting in many jobs between developing and developed and developing countries, but sooner or later that is going to be happening more and more. Again, look at the case of Brazil. I found this information for the period 1980 to the year 2009, where also you see a decline in some type of jobs, and a relatively slight increase in the jobs that are for the people who have higher education credentials. So, and then finally, the big question of if it pays back to study. So there are different studies that are being done periodically to try to have a sense of if it pays back or not for societies and individuals to study. So just in the case of Africa, it has been known that 1 year increase in the tertiary education stock could raise in the long run the level of GDP per capita about a factor of 12.2%. So this is the case of Africa. But look at the case of other parts of the world. The study that the World Bank does on private returns on tertiary education, which is based on household surveys and then the credentials that individuals in those households have or the preparation they have in terms of education, shows that the average rate of return to year of schooling is more or less 10%. One extra year of education in your life, 10% extra revenues that you will have in your life as an individual. But surprisingly, in the most recent study, despite the tradition, the subsector of the educational system where globally there is the highest rate of return is precisely tertiary education. So it pays back. With the exception of the MENA countries, in all of the rest of the world, there is a higher rate of return for individuals if they go to tertiary education in comparison to the ones who don't. And of course, the information is, you know, there are significant variations, and we have the paper in, for the ones who are interested in this analysis. However, returns are declining. And this can be explained very easily by basically two factors. The first factor is, you know, as more graduates of tertiary education are in the system, you know, they have to share the pie among more people, right? But the second one has to do with the issue of employability and skills of the graduates. So if graduates don't have enough skills, most probably they might take jobs that are at a lower sort of required skills to the ones for which, in theory, at least, they were prepared. And that poses sort of a diminishing factor, if you want, in the pressure in the salaries in any economy in the world. Look at the case of Brazil. From the year 1982 to the year 2007, there is a very visible decline in the private returns on tertiary education. However, interestingly, still there is a positive return. But look at other countries where now they are in the negatives, and that is you know, quite challenging. And we know that also, in addition to economic returns, there are significant social returns. It's not only about money. And there are many studies showing that higher education represents also significant social returns. We know that higher education is the principal factor of social mobility. I don't know how many here in this group are first generation students in the respective families. Let's see how many here. How many are the first in your family who had the opportunity to have higher education? Okay. It's relatively small, right? Interestingly, guess what will happen if I will ask this question about 10 or 15 years ago? You know, or in a different scenario, because this is a scenario of people which is greatly educated. But in many countries, as you know, just many of the graduates of tertiary education are just first generation. And then when you see to the next generation, the kids of those individuals, a great majority of them are now having access to tertiary education. So we know that there are higher rates of kids with education, especially if the mother has higher education studies. It's the main factor explaining access to or tertiary education attainment is the degree of the mother rather than the degree of the father. We know that higher education builds citizenship. We know that makes people more aware of the society in which they live. In theory, people with higher education has healthier lives and longer lives. In theory, people with tertiary education are more tolerant to the ones who didn't have that opportunity, and also individuals which are more conscious of the environment. Those are just a few of the social benefits that also many times we don't calculate, but also have a significant importance in tertiary education. So BRICS countries have done a significant effort in supporting tertiary education. If we see, for instance, expenditures on tertiary education as a percentage of the government expenditures on education, although a challenge with the BRICS countries is that the information is not as consistent and as available as in other countries, and as you will see that there are some breaks there. But it is interesting to see that. Look at the case of Brazil, the case of China, no more recent information, the case of India, the case of Russia, and then the case of South Africa. So there has been a significant investment with different variations, of course, in public investment in tertiary education in BRICS countries. We see that, for instance, expenditures per student in tertiary education in US dollars, purchasing parity power. Look at, again, it's interesting, a similar landscape. The case of Brazil, the case of China, the case of India, the case of Russia, and then the case of South Africa. So, again, there is a significant investment that public is making and governments are making in tertiary education. But, of course, there is unlimited need for resources. I'm sure that if I ask here the question of if tertiary education needs more money, most probably you will say definitively yes, especially in Brazil and the current situation. I was chatting last night with colleagues in the dinner that I remember being here in Brazil, I don't know, probably about 4 or 5 years ago, and having a conversation with a rector of a university who told me that the main problem they had at that time is that they had a lot of money and they didn't know how to expend that money. And I was saying, oh, la la, you know, that would be terrific in other parts of the world. Most probably, if I go there to that university now and I ask the same question, probably he will scream at me and say, you know, don't tell me about this, right? Because now the landscape is completely different. So tertiary education believes that needs more money. And but probably we need to recognize that the context is very different and most probably will be very different in the future. And believe it or not, might be that it is nothing related to higher education, but it will impact higher education. So we do in the bank a survey. The bank has about 80 people in staff which are interacting with governments all over the world in matters related to tertiary education. So we try to have a temperature of what they see, what they observe, and look at what they say, what they observe. You know, the question about what are the top three issues that tertiary education is going to be facing in the region: quality, employability, and funding. And when you ask the question, what will be the main priorities that they observe that governments will be paying attention to in tertiary education in the next 5 years? Look at that. The gap between higher education and employment first, and secondly, funding models for tertiary education. So unfortunately, you know, the past doesn't exist anymore. And we better deal with this scenario in a much more realistic way, because probably the old times may not come back soon if they come back. The question is if the current model of funding of tertiary education is sustainable in the future. And this is an analysis in the case of Africa when we were trying to compare what was the rhythm of expenditures in tertiary education in comparison to the available resources. And you can see that there is a gap between what is needed and what it is available. And we may make the best case about why it is important tertiary education, but like ourselves, there are many more actors in our respective societies who claim that what they are looking for is probably more important than tertiary education. And one thing that probably it is important to recognize is that tertiary education many times is being seen as a regressive investment in our societies. And many voices are making the case that since tertiary education is very expensive and it benefits just a few, that probably might be better to invest in other sectors of education, or that probably might be better to invest in other sectors of the economy. And of course, we need to make the case that this is the worst decision that a country can make, but we need to have the evidence to show that. Because just asking for more money for the sake of more money may not work, as we are seeing in different countries. So our dilemma is, who should pay for education? Do we pay as individuals, our families, or society, and the taxpayers at the end of the day? Look at the case of Mexico. In my country, who enrolls in tertiary education? And you can see in the number one is the people who are the poorest in the country. And on the right, the decile number 10 is the richest people in the country. So the picture is very clear. The ones who attend tertiary education are the ones who come from better off families. And the change has been in between 2000 and 2012, you know, where the bandwidth has grown is in the middle class, not in the poorest, and of certainly in the richest decile of the society. But then when we talk about the funding, look at what happens. If we see the distribution of public spending on tertiary education by income decile, guess what happens? Of course, public spending in tertiary education is benefiting whom? The poorest or the richest? Right? The richest, right? So what happens in Brazil? Something similar or not? So it is progressive or is regressive, a fully funded public tertiary education? That's a big question that societies have to discuss. And it is a very hard and difficult discussion because nobody likes that, a change of, you know, the status quo. But we have an issue in our societies in terms of who pays for education. So the question is free truly free? Well, at the end of the day, there is no free. Somebody will have to pay, either by having no access to other resources or opportunities, or by having to pay back for the failures that others didn't work on. So the case of Brazil, you may see that very similar picture, even though in Brazil there has been a much more significant increase of access to tertiary education by the lowest decile, which is from 1 to 13. But still, you see very acute trend there that shows basically that the ones benefiting from tertiary education are the ones who have a little bit more capacity, why not, to cost share a little bit of the education. So in BRICS countries, as it has been negated by you as the experts, I'm just telling you my observations, the current funding policies and practices are very, there is not a single pattern. And I don't know, I have another, don't worry, I have another 500 slides and I will finish. So I'm on time or still? Okay. 5 to 10 minutes, very good. I will maximize them as much as I can. So we see different models of and different cases in the BRICS countries. You know, for instance, in terms of budget allocations to tertiary education, there are countries where you see the historically based funding. You see countries where there is much more input-based funding, and also the countries that are experiencing with the funding formula, with all the limitations and all the advantages that any funding formula might have. Also, we see that there are countries where there is an increased emphasis on shifting the typical allocation of funding in tertiary education towards a funding which is much more linked to performance or to commitments for future performance. And some pockets of funding that many countries are using in order to support some strategic initiatives, such as the case of the RUSA initiative in India, or the project of the world-class universities in Russia, and the Science Without Borders in the case of Brazil. So you find that many countries are experiencing with some pockets of specific funding, which is aligned to very specific strategic elements. And again, we see also that there has been, as funding are shifting or diminishing in tertiary education, that there is an increased call for tertiary education institutions to look for models of much more private funding, cost sharing, external assistance, creating and or looking for support from foundations, even the sales of services, and also revenues coming from external aid for research and development. So just to end, some issues for consideration. First, competing demands with limited resources and little evidence about the impact. So tertiary education is facing competing demands. There are other actors in our societies which are demanding for resources, and they may have probably more legitimate reasons to ask for money or a better case to make based on evidence. Because many times, unfortunately, in tertiary education, it is very sad to tell you, after working all my life in tertiary education, we have a lot of anecdotes, and we are the ones who are able to develop the evidence, but we don't have a lot of evidence about how good we are in what we do. The other element is the reallocation of public resources in tertiary education towards strategic, ambitious goals. And the question is if this is a smart idea or not. And that is a big question to discuss. Is it good for a country to divert some funding in tertiary education just to one wonderful idea of a great institution or not? And this is something that is debatable. And there are many, you know, factors in favor and against. The endless question about if tertiary education is a public or a private good. And there is no answer for that. There might be, we might have endless discussions about that. And this is something that, again, depends on many factors to be decided. Other issue for consideration is if it is the increased private provision of tertiary education, an ideological shift, or just as an author said recently, a financial opportunism from governments. And many times we see more the second than the first. Of course, later when the debate arises, then it becomes the first, the one that is debated. But at the end of the day, many times it is just the limited capacity that governments have to cope with a huge demand by allowing private providers to provide some kind of education. And this is something that we should be very conscious about it. Is there any room for increased effectiveness in tertiary education? It is not only about money. And again, we know that there is room for increased effectiveness. All of you who work in universities know that very well, that sometimes you wonder why decisions are made in using the money in X and nor in Z. And again, there is room for efficiency for sure. Look at just, for instance, about the dropout rates in tertiary education. Or look at about, for instance, the years to end tertiary education. There are countries, it is not the case of BRICS, but there are countries in which it takes 8 years to finish with a bachelor's degree. Do you think 8 years is, don't you think it is a little bit much? And then, of course, the issues of autonomy, accountability, quality, regulations, etc. So how can financing policy improve incentives and capacity? Well, on one way, of course, there is no sort of a hidden or magic solution here. On one way is identifying priority activities for public spending. In other words, where a government wants to invest the money. Where is the best social return and economic return as society in either investing in something that others are unable to invest or something that will result in a significant economic welfare and social welfare for the country. And of course, the second angle is by funding effectively, by increasing public funding smartly, by improving efficiency of the public spending, by complementing with private funding what is the public provision of tertiary education, and of course, by developing a mechanism such as a funding linked to results or performance contracts. So, and of course, we can talk hours about if for-profit is bad or good. And I might say it is bad, but not. And I might say it is not bad, but yes. Depends on many factors. You know, I don't think for-profit is a bad thing in our societies. What I think is wrong is when our tertiary education systems don't have the capacity to prevent those which are not providing good service of tertiary education to be there. That's what is the problem. So we need to find ways to strengthen the quality assurance and quality enhancement mechanisms, and also the adequate regulations to avoid those which are abusing the system. But believe it or not, that applies to private for-profit, to private non-for-profit, and to public institutions, because at the end of the day, also public institutions are using the money of the society. So it is not just bad or good. It is a matter of the context that we need to take in consideration. So some of the tools that we have seen in other countries for financially sustainable tertiary education policies, one of them is improving the management of public financing, managing more adequately the trends of student flows. Further, we believe that tertiary education institutions need to embrace the change themselves. So who told us that the university shouldn't and cannot change? You know, the world is changing. Don't you think that probably universities should venture to think that there is a possibility of change? The ones who criticize tertiary education say that those were the universities of the Italy in the 1350, and that today's universities are exactly the same. Probably there has been a change in the way that we use PowerPoints and stuff like that, but at the end of the day, we continue replicating the same model. I am the one who knows, you are the ones who don't know. I'm the teacher, you are the ignorance, and you better play by my rules, otherwise you are out. Again, I'm just talking about other country, not about your universities. A paradox, as George Keller said, is that universities are institutions created to prepare leaders and professionals, but are being administered by amateurs. That's what he said, of course. So those are some of the newspapers that you see, you know, in different parts of the world, basically saying what is going on in tertiary education institutions. We can see even some books, even movies, which are, you know, questioning the what we do in our ivory tower institutions. You know, let me propose to you that communities are large, are in a way skeptical, unconvinced, exigent, and a little bit becoming impatient of what we do or what we don't do in tertiary education. And don't forget that we have new type of students. Those are different. You know, it's what I refer to as the Generation M, the students who probably see technology a little bit different. They don't think the same way we used to think. They don't think the same way that we used to be prepared, because they are multitask, doing many things at the same time. You know, they consider technology in different ways to the way we used to consider. Even that is changing the way youth exists today. I like this picture of a museum because, you know, the guys in the painting say, you know, what is going on there? Nobody pays attention to us anymore. And of course, believe it or not, that will have an impact in the way that tertiary education may be shifting in future years. So what happens in my home, where my kids know more technology than myself, happens in the classroom. And students complain legitimately that we don't use the technology adequately to teach them more adequately about the future. So many times, students may think about ourselves as teachers, probably different to what we believe they think about us. And of course, it is not a perfect thing. You know, sometimes, you know, they are constantly occupied with the copy-paste culture and then not very doing deep analysis of things. And even they speak a different language and write a different language that sometimes we don't understand. And of course, that creates a significant generational gap that, believe it or not, it happens in our societies, it happens in our home, and it happens in the classroom. I will skip this because I know that we have a mathematician here, but those are some responses that students have to tests in different parts. And you know, that does very well, right? This is the one that I like the most. This, please expand this expression. Of course, it's expand. And then the teacher says, very funny, Peter. Yeah. Well, you know, why this matters? Well, because just think about the fact that by the year 2050, all information that exists in the world today will represent only 1% of the information that a student will have in wherever it will exist, that it will be named university, which I believe is going to be a little bit different to what we think it is a university today. So think about the fact, but this year, the year 2015, all your students are digital native. All your students. So we better be prepared for that, because again, they see technology a little bit different to what we are. And in higher education, we are experts in the art of ambiguity, which is continue doing the same things but waiting for different results. It is up to us to act. And also, we are very good, and we hear this during these days, of blaming others for the problems we face in tertiary education. It's the syndrome of the chicken, as we say. You know, the chicken on the top is blaming on the chicken on the lower level, and then the lower level to the lower level, and the lower level to the lowest level. So when we talk about the problems on tertiary education, say, yeah, you know, these high schools are terrible. They are not preparing people adequately. And then you go to high school and they say, yeah, yeah, these elementary schools are very bad. And then you continue going back, and then at the end of the day, the ones which are guilty are the parents. So the ones criticizing higher education say that it is like the crisis of the Titanic, you know, the ship is sinking, and then the first priority, the captain says, is the crew. The second priority is that the ship should continue working. The third is, let's repair the ship. And the last one is, oh my God, students are gonna be graduating. Okay, let's see, hopefully they can make it. So, and of course, you know, many times in our institutions, we have these significant bureaucracies preventing our work or just playing by the book. And again, we need many more things to do. There is room for improvement, I believe, after living many years in tertiary education, for us to improve. And also, there is no magic formula. What it may work in one case may not work in other cases. So if the World Bank comes and tells you this is the solution, that's wrong, because again, all depends on the context. I just finished just with two quotes, one from Darwin, who said, it is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one who is more responsive to change. And then the one from Paul Valéry, who said that the trouble with our times is that the future is not what it used to be. Thank you very much for your patience. I truly appreciate your time.
Okay, in a short period of time, based on Francisco's standard, he gave us a very comprehensive, informative, funny introduction of the BRICS education, also including everything, every issue related to education. So without wasting any time, let's open to the comments and the question. So we'll do a small change. Francisco would like to answer every question right after you ask it, so we have more interactive way. Okay, let's open to comments and questions right now.
Francisco, recently Germany, I think a few years ago, started charging tuition from students, and this was a regional arrangement that some of the regions did it, some didn't. And after some time, I think the politicians started using that as a debate for the next elections. And it seems that in most places, the ones that said, we are going back, sometimes from one party, sometimes from the other party, to free tuition won. Mm-hmm. And now it seems Germany went back to free, no tuition. So we see in the UK the trend towards tuition, more tuition, more tuition. So both countries are countries probably that in the demographic scheme is older people. So why do you see that in one, like the UK, it seems there is a call for that, and in another one in Europe, it didn't go the same way. And since we are probably reaching that kind of thing some years from now, and so I would like you to comment on those two countries. Yep.
Michael. It is on, can you hear me? Yeah. Just to start with the last quotation you have there, which says that the future is not what it used to be. And there's another quotation you also have there, which is about being skeptical. which is where I place myself for whatever reasons. I place myself within that domain. And the reason why I would place myself within that domain is the fact that it's almost impossible to predict what may happen tomorrow, today. You know, I'm thinking about the oil crisis all of a sudden. I'm thinking about the load shedding in South Africa and the platinum crisis in South Africa. I'm thinking about the refugees in Europe. It's just amazing what we're going through. If we could predict the world that way, wouldn't we build a paradise tomorrow? I'm just wondering why that dark side of the world is actually informing those predictions that we have.
Well, thank you. It was very interesting, but I think Michael just, you know, hit the nail. While you were presenting or thinking about the Black Swan, I was a very nice book by Nassim Taleb about the unpredictability of events. In the first, you started with some bias, you know, presenting some bias about how things, our convictions about how things work. But you also gave very interesting examples of, you know, unpredictable events. So I see a kind of a contradiction there. And Africa in particular suffered a lot because of the convictions that World Bank had about this, you know, story of rates of return, even the social rate of return. Africa suffered a lot when they told us that we shouldn't have universities, that we shouldn't have ivory towers. But surprisingly, the top research universities are the ones also who are actually contributing more to development. Harvard is much more well-connected with its community than a poor teaching university that is trying to teach what is not producing. So again, back to Michael's, how can you predict? How can you make such precise predictions, but at the same time, in your last, slides, you're talking about that very same unpredictability of events. Thanks.
Last one.
No? Well, Yaroslav Kuzminov from High School of Economics, Russia. Francisco, you show us some exams of expenditure per student, but do you think that also is very significant indicator is the distribution of expenditure per student between different higher education institutions in one country? For example, in Russia, we have more than 8 times difference in some expenditure between the highest rank and lowest rank institutions. I'm sure that in other BRIC countries, it's also the same. Do you think that is it could be considered as one of the significant features of the BRICS educational economy? That's the first question. Second question is future, some prognosis of quality of tertiary education in different countries. You show us that in China we will expect much less demographic pressure on the system of tertiary education because of the demographic reasons, and partly in Russia. At the same time, we not expect such in the coming 15 years in other BRIC countries. Do you think, could we prognose some kind of behavior, of changing behavior of educational system in China because of the of this situation? My own prediction would be that the China universities will meet the same challenge as Russian one. A lot of weak students, Russian Chinese universities now enjoy. A lot of very clever students, students among the first two quantiles of the people's completing the high school. And in year 2025, it changed, and the face of Chinese university will change.
Okay, you know, this is the best section of any presentation because the section of questions and evasives. So I will, of course, I have no response to a concrete response to some of the things that are totally unpredictable. That's correct. That's why I insisted that we are just making scenarios, right? And I tend to be on the skeptical side too, in many ways, about a good number of things. So let me go sort of gradually on the different elements. Renato's comment, you know, there is not a single pattern. It is like, you know, you see that happening in many parts. Hold a second. Let me respond to you after. So there is there is not a single pattern, you know, and you see that just here in the region. Look at what is happening in the neighboring country, in Chile, where there is this big debate about, you know, the change in the funding system of tertiary education, which is going to be a longer debate for sure. And and then the case of Mexico is another significant one in which the rector of the National University wanted just to increase a small fee in tertiary education, and he lost his job. The university was on strike for 8 months, I believe, and nothing was able to change. So those are, of course, very difficult situations, many times influenced by politics rather than by evidence. But of course, politics plays a significant role in the decision making in our societies. It would be naive not to think that sometimes even what we believe that not very rational decisions are the ones which really are, you know, driving the decision making. And context matters a lot. So why in Germany they decided to go in one direction and then to revert the process? It just was because it was politics involved in that decision. UK, with the current government, of course, is considering those possibilities, again, because there is a huge political factor that is being weighted there. But again, in analyzing those cases, we cannot say that the pattern is very similar because it depends on many of the context. Now, in terms of the skepticism and the impossibility to predict what will happen tomorrow, I fully agree with that. You know, if you had the wrong impression that, and this is my mistake, in telling that this or some of the things that I mentioned for sure will happen, that will be misleading. Because if anyone who tells you that the scenarios about the future are fully predictable and for sure will happen, definitely is totally wrong. So definitely, yeah, there are many things that we cannot anticipate. The only thing I'm doing right now is presenting to you some of the evidence that exists as of today, and of course speculating about what I can see as potential consequences of that. It might be the case, remember, that what Peter Drucker said many years ago. He said about 20 years ago that universities will disappear, that universities are were not suitable anymore to the needs of society. Well, in a way, he was wrong, because universities keep emerging. Universities still are here. But in a way, also, he was right, because he was basically telling that probably a little bit of change needed to be taken in consideration. Now, in the case of the history of the bank, the World Bank's imposing or supporting some initiatives in tertiary education, you know, I can tell you about the present, and I can tell you a little bit about the past too. We just produced a paper in the World Bank. It's the title of the paper is "What Matters in Tertiary Education," and it makes, in my opinion, a very good narrative analysis of that history of the World Bank's engagement with governments in supporting decisions. There is a document. There is a book. That it's one of the policy documents of the bank of those years that literally said, I don't have exact quote, but literally said that it might be better for societies to invest in elementary education, because that's where there is the highest economic and social returns. And of course, that was automatically being interpreted by both banks and governments, that signaled that by investing in basic education, we should de-invest in tertiary education. And I think that my position, and every time that I interact with governments in many countries, I insist on the need to invest in tertiary education while not de-investing in basic education. Because at the end of the day, the whole system and the whole society suffers by that inadequate decision. And the case that I think not me, but all of us have to be in our respective societies is to make the case that investing in education in general and in tertiary education is something very significant. Being said that, also we should recognize that many times some of the policies that we have in our governments, which are developed with good intentions, especially the ones that have to do with the funding and the ones that have to do with the decision of free education or cost-shared education, many times the evidence shows very clearly that are not having the social benefits that we expect. Again, look at the case of my own country. In the case of Mexico, that is very clear. You know, public funding is going to the ones who have more. Do they have to share some of their cost? I think they have to do it in order to support the ones who don't have any money. And we can see in many African countries with the public system of higher education that it continues being very selective, very elitist, and still is just benefiting the ones which are the better off from those societies. And I don't think that is fair, because that, at the end of the day, creates unequal societies and continues prolonging the stratification in our societies. And that is, at the end of the day, is affecting all of us. Now, the comments from the rector of the Higher School of Economics, HSE University in Russia. Yes, that's one of the challenges that exist. And when I was making this analysis on funding on tertiary education in the BRICS countries, is that there is not too much information on funding. And there is not too much comparable information. And there is not too much detailed information. But your point is very, very... it's totally sure. You know, there is a big difference in terms of how much money is expended in tertiary education. But if you dissect a little bit more the information, you can find very interesting trends in terms of where that money is going to, in what type of institutions it's going to, and then what is the return that that investment, social investment, is having in those type of institutions. And this will be an interesting matter for further analysis and further discussion, because that's where we can find also the opportunity for more adequate efficiencies in the system. Because it might be the case that money is being used where the return is not as good from a social standpoint. And then, of course, the issue of the quality and the potential change in behavior in the education system. In the case of China, of course, I will defer that to my colleagues in China to give more information. But something that is intriguing observing in the case of China is how in recent months, there has been a whole discussion in China about the reclassification of the tertiary education institutions between the ones which are technical, two-year technical schools and the universities. So there is a big debate right now, discussion in the decision-making in China, but again, I know about that because I read about that in the news, and our colleagues from China can provide us with more information. But definitely, of course, there is thinking there about the way that they need to reconvert the higher education system in order to respond to a changing context in future years.
Let me have time for one or two questions. Anymore? Yeah, first, you second.
Okay, that'll be fine. Hi. I want to change the emphasis of the questions a bit. We all know there's going to be a BRICS bank, or maybe it's functioning already, and the Indian is appointed to be the president. So from the World Bank perspective, do you think it could or should set its foot in the spheres of education or higher education?
I'm sorry, can you speak louder? Because the noise of the air conditioning, I couldn't understand very well your question. I'm sorry, I apologize.
Okay, there is going to be a BRICS bank.
Nah.
Right, mm-hmm. This is my question.
Yeah.
It might be functioning already, and India is now appointed as its president, the first president. Mm-hmm. So from the World Bank perspective, what do you think, do you think it could or should set its foot in the sphere of education? If yes, what could it do?
Very good. Good question.
That's probably the last question.
Mm-hmm. Well, I appreciate the fact that you actually answered my question at the beginning, but I need to stress one point here. Mm-hmm. And the point is that I remember it was after 1994, just a couple of years, and some experts came with modeling program that was introduced in South Africa. Mm-hmm. I was part of the training in the process. The outcome of that process was something similar to this, concerning teachers. So they came with a modeling around supply and demand of teachers. And they came with these wonderful predictions of what would happen in the future. The conclusion was that South Africa had an oversupply of teachers. You know what happened? All provincial departments retrenched teachers. Today, there's a school crisis in South Africa. That's the reason why sometimes it makes me restless when I listen to these kinds of predictions without the necessary contextualization of these figures, because they're dangerous.
Mm-hmm. I would probably argue with this, Isaac Frumin, HSC Russia. I would probably argue with this disbelief in any predictions, with all my respect. I think that the diagrams that you just showed, they definitely present some long-term trends. And to summarize, am I right that what we know for sure that we expect further expansion of the higher education systems, mm-hmm. full stop, or tertiary education. And probably details we don't know, but the expansion we can expect, and therefore the issue of financing this expansion, because probably there is no economic rationale behind this expansion. The issue of the financing of this expansion is probably the most pressing issue. Am I right?
Yep. Let me the last comment and then
Okay. Thank you. I think you've tackled some of my issues or some of my questions. There was a summit in March in Dakar, Higher Education in Africa.
Yeah.
And there was a presentation there by another World Bank officer, and he mentioned that. But the consequences are there. And the point is, words are not just, you know, words can do things, especially when it's World Bank. If this was said, let's say, in a, you know, academic environment and so on and so on, perhaps I'll take that, you know, this is just a way of thinking. It's probably based on, you know, an economic rationale, et cetera, et cetera. But it's more than that. It has implications. Yesterday, one of the speakers mentioned that, for instance, universities are not just, you know, utilitarian, you know, producers of graduates for the market. They are more than that. Actually, the origin, the history of universities are not related to this concept of market. But when you say, for instance, that we'll have a crisis of job, you know, because of this disparity of supply and demand, then, you know, you can't just leave it like that. Because that surely will have an impact on the way, you know, those who draft the policies are going to think. When you say that you have, you know, interviewed employers and they think that they are not getting the best, you know, graduates, that is not just in vain. Why should we believe them? What, that kind of evidence?
Well,
I mean, so this, I could go on and on and on. Almost every point you made,
well,
I could also point out some sort of bias there.
Very good. So let me go in a consecutive order. The BRICS Bank, you know, you may ask the bank, the bank spokesperson about it. But what I have here, you know, most of the time is that this is a good idea, and that if there are more opportunities to expand support for tertiary education and in this particular case in the BRICS countries by other entity, that's fine, why not? You know, that does that create a concern in the sort of the operations of the bank? I'm not familiar with that, because the scale of activities that we do in tertiary education is not as it might be probably in other sectors. But the, again, I'm just reinterpreting to you what I have read, that sort of the official position of the bank is that it is a good idea that other players are going to be in the field of developing, supporting you know, development, in this particular case in the BRICS countries. I am aware for sure about the fact that a good number of operational procedures, etc., are being sort of, I don't say copied, but at least, you know, used. There is not, they are not trying to reinvent the wheel in the way that they are operationalizing the new bank. So that's all I can tell you about that. So, but I believe it's a very good idea. Now, in terms of the comments about the, again, a potential misinterpretation of what I said in terms of the models that I'm proposing or anything like that, following up a little bit more what Isaac said, you know, the only thing is sure, and again, just because the numbers are there, is that the demographics in the world, and particularly in the BRICS countries, will continue calling for expansion and diversification of tertiary education. Now, is that going to happen faster or slower? Or is there going to be resistance to that? I cannot predict that, but just the numbers show that. And again, it might happen or may not happen. Of, you know, nobody can predict that. But no question about the fact that there will be an increased demand for higher education access. And the more we see people getting out of poverty and then seeing education and seeing subsequent levels of education as something feasible, that legitimate pressure will continue to exist. In other words, if for someone the dream of higher education was not a possible dream in the previous generation, now it is a possibility. And it is a legitimate demand that I don't think anybody can say that, you know, somebody deserves or somebody doesn't deserve. I think we need, and I say we, I refer to the ones who already have benefited from higher education, including myself, have the responsibility to make possible as much as possible, sorry for the redundance, for the ones who are coming before us to have access to decent and relevant higher education. And I think that is our social responsibility that we cannot negate, no matter if I work on the World Bank or in any other place, or no matter where you are. I think all of us should share and continue looking for that. Now, in your comments, and we can discuss that on detail, because many of the things that I made a reference to is not me who is telling those. You know, those are the results of studies that show, and I present the source there. You know, when I present information about the level of satisfaction or dissatisfaction of the employers, it is based on studies that are being done by people which are doing that type of analysis. Do we agree with that or not? I expressed personally my skepticism. I mentioned that very clearly. I expressed my skepticism about those numbers. But again, I presented that because this is evidence of opinions of employers about what they think it is happening in higher education graduates, performance of graduates of higher education. Now, the summit of higher education that you were making a reference to happening in Africa, the message from Claudia Costin, which is the senior director of education of the World Bank from Brazil, by the way, was very clear. She made a very clear statement saying that no longer we believe that tertiary education is not a priority. She said tertiary education is a priority for the world, and I can show you her speech, in which she clearly said that, you know, it is important for societies to invest in tertiary education, as I said. So, you know, I think, you know, it's a matter of interpretation, but I believe that the position is very clear. So.
Okay, I think time is up, so I don't have any remarks. I just want to occupy everyone 10 seconds to express my gratitude to Simon, to organizer, and to give me this chance to learn from all the excellent scholar and educators. Finally, let's give Francisco another round of applause to help. Thanks for the excellent speech. And we conclude our panel.